Welcome to Live Action Star Wars. I'm Ralph.
I'm James.
And today we are discussing Light and Magic Part 1, Gang of Outsiders?
Gang of Outsiders, yeah. It's right. Cool. It sounds like a punk album. It's awesome.
I'm struggling. Here's the deal. We're doing this on a Thursday, and the reason is because I didn't want to have to wake up at like 5:30 and then rush to do this. So I'm like, we'll do it on Thursday. I can watch it and then we're good to go.
Yeah,
and then
you don't have to worry about spoilers for a behind the scenes series. So the urgency isn't quite as strong.
Right. And then if they release them all at once, we could do Wednesdays. Go back to Wednesdays, which is what happened. Yeah. Which is that's happening. There's a bit of a issue. We have a 1 week overlap between Andor and the final episode of this, as far as our schedule goes going on Wednesday.
Yeah.
I think the real issue is holding back and watching one a week.
I watched one, and then I was like, oh, I really want to watch the next one. But I've waited. I was like, I'll at least podcast about it. And then I'm probably going to watch episode 2 tonight at work.
Yeah, that's the thing. I feel like we have 6 weeks of this. We have Andor in 5 weeks, which is like essentially a month.
Yeah.
And I'm like, can we do 2 episodes at a time and then do data links in between? I'm like thinking about any way I can get to watch these faster because I absolutely love this. I went to the panel and we saw a lot of stuff in the panel, including the opening of this. And I was like, this is going to be amazing. Mm. And Stevie was like, this is going to be amazing. And everybody who saw the panel was like, this, I can't wait. And then to see the people who are tweeting about it are all people I really like.
Okay.
And respect, like, it's almost like, not that I don't respect everyone I follow, but it's like everyone has this reverence for this documentary are like the people who are like, I just want to tweet about good Star Wars.
And I saw exactly the same sort of responses. Like, this didn't get a massive push. It wasn't, when I opened up Disney Plus, it wasn't the first thing on the banner. It wasn't their big new thing that you always get with the new Star Wars properties. You always get with the new Stevie agrees that this is a little bit different from the Elstree documentary we covered last week. The new Marvel, the new Star Wars, they always get the big, like, the opening banner. This was like 2 or 3 along, which makes sense for a behind the scenes thing, but
yeah,
I was so excited for it, and I'm glad that it lived up to that hype. But yeah, without getting that big push, you're not getting the mass amounts of tweets and feedback from people, and that is unfortunately where a lot of the negativity and toxicity comes from. You're getting people that not even hunted it down like deeply, but like have gone out of their way to watch this. It hasn't been forced.
I feel like a lot of the people that are talking about it are guys like us who grew up in the dark time to the point where there was no Star Wars. So the only thing we had was to learn more about ILM because ILM kept going. And so
they were still there. They were still putting out new things.
Like when they show a picture of Richard Edlund without his name underneath, I'm like, oh, that's Richard Edlund.
Yeah.
Oh, that's Phil Tippett. Oh, that's
Dennis Mirren.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things like when we were seeing Dennis Mirren, and I remember in like 1993, I was 6 years old, super excited for Jurassic Park. And so I was watching like the behind the scenes things for Jurassic Park, and you'd see Dennis Mirren there. And I was like, oh, it's that guy. He made a Star Wars. Like he was making Star Wars. Like, and I already recognized his face. I might not have been able to sort of go deep onto exactly what he did and how responsible he was for everything, but I recognized his face. And you know, you see the silly beards that they all had back in like 76, and it's it's great. And I think the thing that I've really enjoyed about this first episode, and I'm sure it will continue on through the rest of the series, is that it's told narratively. It is a behind the scenes, but it's moving through chronologically, and it has a narrative structure to it, to the point where this episode ends on a cliffhanger for a documentary series, sort of. Yes. But the way it's set up.
I want to talk about that cliffhanger for a bit. It's hilarious.
Yeah, it really is.
George saying he wasn't happy, and then mics drop, audio, live audio dumps out where it's Lawrence Kasdan said, "Ooh, now fold your arms." Because it's a weird timing of Lucas saying, "I wasn't happy," and then him folding his arms. And I was telling Stevie, I was like, you know, like, it, there's no, the cliffhanger's not really an issue because we know that Star Wars was successful. Also, did you see that cliffhanger coming? I did, because I know the story of George Lucas coming back from England and being mad that nothing was done.
Like nothing, like, they had two shots, yeah.
But what's great about this episode is that it shows us all of their side of the story, who these guys are, and what they were doing.
They weren't just dicking around in the car park on a slip and slide. Yeah. They were they were building all of this stuff. It was, of course, that it was all going to happen. Like, the actual shots themselves were going to happen in the last 6 months. But, like, everything up to that was still very productive. They were doing 12 to 18-hour days as they were, and they were living there.
And we all know, and they showed in this, a new angle of George Lucas being sad on the Death Star set. Yeah. We get some new shots of that. And so his mind is completely on getting this film done.
And not done having with it as well, it seems.
There's no internet. They have a phone in ILM. Yeah. And so, like, for him to come back after this agonizing shoot and having two shots, which I've known forever that they always, the first shot of ILM that they ever did was the escape pod.
Yeah.
And, but it was funny because I didn't really know that they also had the gun in the Death Star trench, and they kept talking about that. And I'm like, that's like barely even an effect shot that anybody cares. No one ever talks about.
It's an iconic visual. Like, we all know it. Yes. Like, you say it and I can see it like perfectly, the angle of it and everything, but it's just, anyone could
both do model shots.
Yeah.
They're not special effects. They're just shot in camera model shots.
Yeah.
And I think it's funny how now for me watching that Death Star gun shot is now like almost a punchline, or it's just seeing them keep showing it.
Oh shit. We need to have something done before the boss gets home sort of thing. It's,
oh my God.
It's when you've had a party and you know your parents are going to be home and you got to do a real mad cleanup. So you want to like leave out some potpourri and you're just like, I don't know, something. It feels like the equivalent of, oh shit, dad's coming home. Let's just do something real quick.
At least the escape pod has, it's integral to the story.
Yeah.
And it's visually interesting, and it's probably a, I don't know, 5 second long shot.
Maybe
the Death Star gun, maybe you see for like 2 seconds.
Yeah.
They may cut back to it, but
yeah, I think we get it a couple of different times.
So I like that it was brought up.
It was the least
significant shot in the whole saga. And that's the one they're like, oh, we did that one too.
Yeah, that was the other shot that we did before George got back. Speaking of George, Stevie mentions it here. George's interview, most lively he's ever been. I mean, certainly in the last like good number of years. But it's also amazing, and I loved seeing a new George Lucas sit-down interview. We haven't seen one in so long.
Right. So it's been 17 years since his last Star Wars.
Yeah.
I mean, he'd worked on Clone Wars and stuff. So this is like the end of his previous dark time, like between 83 and 99, that 17 years. And it's kind of, it's George talking to being excited about Star Wars after his big break, after his big long vacation away from it.
It does lead into, you know, a lot of people are speculating now, because there was a lot of remastered non-special edition footage in this, like there was a lot of the sort of 4K renderings of stuff there, that, and Adam mentions it here, watching the first night and the remastered footage looked amazing. It really did. Like, seeing George talking about this again, if you're gonna put those out and put them as an option on Disney Plus, having George almost signing off on them and saying like, look,
how about,
I love the special editions. They're his thing. That's the versions that he's always said. He's always said that they are his preferred version. But he's like, but I understand, having his blessing essentially to put them out would be a really nice thing.
And I feel like this documentary would make him
a lead in.
Sort of LM and what they did, and use it as a historical version of Star Wars and call it Star Wars Legacy Edition.
Classic.
Or something.
And
I feel like use it as a tool. Because the way these guys are talking about like how it was in 1976 and how they were doing everything they could, like the stuff they put together is so insane. Like, show what they accomplished, show what they did. I don't want to have to see a VHS version.
Yeah, you don't want it. You don't like. I don't mind most of the special edition stuff. Like we talked about it whenever we talked about any of the original trilogy. And there's a lot of it that doesn't hold up visual effects wise, but showing the raw, essentially the most of it being in camera shot stuff, it's showing that is nice for the ILM guys who are still out there and they're still so proud of everything that they accomplished.
Yeah.
Like stripping it back and just showing off their work, it is good, and I think it is something that should be at least an option on there. I mean, you've got a streaming platform, why not put it up there?
One of my favorite things, and I don't know, I feel like this isn't a Lawrence Kasdan thing because it's directed by Lawrence Kasdan.
Yeah. Is the whole series done by him? I would assume it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah. And there is a shot, one shot of the Pillsbury Doughboy popping fresh. Okay. Now, I think in From Star Wars to Jedi, and I believe in the Leonard Maltin documentary or the Leonard Maltin interview from the THX releases. George Lucas always mentions, we got guys from everywhere commercials and Pillsbury Doughboy. He always says Pillsbury Doughboy. So somebody, I have a hunch it's John Kasdan. Cause John Kasdan is like us. He's like steep into like Star Wars, Dark Times. Like
he was there.
Solo is a celebration of Dark Times.
Yeah.
I guarantee you, I'll put good credits down saying that John Kasdan said in this montage of commercials, you 100% need to put in the Pillsbury Doughboy because George Lucas mentions that in like all his interviews.
Yeah.
And what's funny about this is George Lucas says the Pillsbury Doughboy in everything because that's just the one thing that he remembered from the guys that were selected, but he didn't select the guys.
No,
that's what changes those other interviews is that George really had one hire. He hired John Dykstra.
Yep.
Went to England. And then John Dykstra is the one who cobbled the group together.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that. And so now when you watch an interview of George Lucas said, yeah, we got guys from like Pillsbury Doughboy. He it's got a laundry list.
Yeah.
He had a phone call with John Dykstra. I got this guy. What are his credits? He worked on this commercial, Pillsbury Doughboy does stop motion.
It just stuck in his memory.
Camera work. And that's the one thing he latched onto. And that's why in the interviews, he always says Pillsbury Doughboy, but
Dykstra is so integral in putting that team together. Like it's his unit, it's his team.
And then Dykstra probably only hit it off with George. George only probably hired him because he flew airplanes and motorcycles.
Yeah, they're very similar in terms of,
right.
Yeah, they both said it.
Dykstra was kind of cool. Like Dykstra was the cool version of George Lucas.
George is the nerd. Yeah.
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 But the nerd who also could tune up the cars and liked all the hot rods and everything. It was just
George wanted a hot rod and John had to build it. And it's like, listen, man, we're going to make you the best hot rod, but we've got to do some special stuff to it. So just like,
chill out. George, having had his car accident and everything, probably was a little bit more like skeptical about getting behind the wheel of it.
Yeah.
It is fun. It's really, really fun. Talking about things that were included in the Pillsbury Doughboy thing, it was nice that to the extent that they were showing off stuff from studios that weren't just under the Disney sort of umbrella. Right. Like they would lean into all of everything else. So that's nice.
The thing too is, you know, we're doing this for live action Star Wars. There is that 70-year chunk.
There's going to be a chunk,
We're not going to be talking about Star Wars.
No. but so many of the people involved cross over that it's
right.
It all comes back to ILM. That's the thing. Like, I mean, you hear James Cameron talking about it. It's like, there would be no Titanic, there would be no Abyss, there would be no Terminator without ILM. Like, they are so integral, and it all comes back to Star Wars. We talk about Star Wars being that focal point of movies. Like, after Jaws, it became Star Wars was the movie that sort of kicked off blockbusters. But like, ILM is so responsible for everything.
It's funny because at the panel, I saw some footage from things from like the Jurassic Park era and stuff. Cool. And it still backs up against the wall. Are we doing Phil Tippett stop motion? Are we doing the CG thing? What is it going to be? Like, last minute, again, last minute, why aren't you getting this done sort of thing? And it's like, that's how ILM works. I feel like I was listening to the Star Wars Minute yesterday, and they had the guest on, I forget his first name, is Todd Alcott, I believe.
Todd.
And he was saying his favorite Star Wars movies are Rogue One and Solo. Awesome. And he loves Solo. Those are his top two favorite Star Wars movies. And he says there's something to be said about having your back to the wall.
Yeah.
And having to rush and get it done. And I've been saying that about Solo. It's one of my favorite things, is it makes it faster, more intense. You cut through the bullshit and you do it. You get everything set up correctly.
You trim the fat. When your
back's to the wall, it's like, we got to go. And there's no time to overthink it.
Yeah.
And there's no time to. And so that's what we're clearly going to be seeing in episode two, is our backs are to the wall. We have 6 months to do this shit.
We got to go. We know the outcome. Yeah.
We know the outcome.
It all works out okay.
Yeah. So it's going to be that. It's going to be backs against the wall, and it's just going to be montage, just them getting shit done. And I'm super fired up. I don't think the blow up with George Lucas is going to be that bad.
No, I mean, even when we've heard about things like that, we see sad George Lucas on the Death Star set sort of thing. He's not blowing up. He's not that kind of guy. He's not having big breakdowns where he's screaming and shouting at anyone. Like, that's never been George's style. He is more likely to just be morose and get in his own feelings and get in his own head in the corner somewhere. So I feel like it's probably more of that. Yeah, he might have a moan at Dykstra or whoever, but in actual fact, like, his only stress is just going to be like, oh, why did I get myself into this? Like, can I not just go back to making these movies in 28 days? As he said, like, I'm used to getting it all done inside of a month.
It's funny that this kind of shows us that George Lucas only wanted to do a dogfight in space because 2001 was too slow.
Yeah. Yeah. And he loves it. He's got reverence for it, but it's like,
that's all he wants.
Sort of movie. Yeah.
Is a dogfight in space. That's the only reason he made Star Wars. Is he wanted old style Flash Gordon dogfight in space. And when he got back, he had an escape pod and a gun. And
didn't even have one of the ships.
Whole point of the movie is you don't have your dogfight in space. So it's like, oh boy. Like,
enjoyed the section where they talk about, because we know that the blockade runner was the original design for the Millennium Falcon, but hearing the explanation as to why, and the fact that it was Space 1999 had just come out, and the hero ship in that was too similar in design to the blockade runner, which when you look at them and the way that they did the shot, they are quite similar designs, like at least stylistically. Go on.
As much as I love the Blockade Runner, it's, I think, my third or fourth favorite ship in Star Wars. Like, that can't be Han Solo's ship. It just can't.
It's not cool. There's nothing cool about it.
There's nothing cool about it.
No, I completely agree. And it's, you know, still to this day, we're dealing with the fallout of that, because obviously the turret guns are those sort of sets are set up so that they're on either side of the ship, not top and bottom. So we deal with that in the weird gravity in the Millennium Falcon, but who cares? It doesn't matter. And hearing the design process, I'm blanking on his name. I didn't write any names down, but
George Johnston?
was Joe Johnston who designed it, wasn't it, in the end? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, hearing Joe Johnston talk about, he was just, you know, he again, back up against the wall, George wanted it right now. And he was at home and he was looking at a stack of dirty dishes and hearing him design the Millennium Falcon. It's great. And it's so much fun. I mean, yeah. Yeah. There was somewhere.
There was designs, right? The designs that they didn't use. He said he did like 8 or 10 of them.
Yeah.
There was one design where the cockpit was right in the middle, like where the top gunner is. And I kind of dug that design.
This is the Haynes manual, like the fake owner's manual for the Millennium Falcon.
Do they have Joe Johnston's designs in there?
They've got all of them, but it's done sort of in universe as if they are other YT configurations that they could have done.
I didn't care for the left side.
No, the left side, it's weird, isn't it? You just throw it on the other side and it just throws it off completely.
Right.
But it makes it so that, you know, the YT-1300 in universe, it was completely modular. Oh. So when you ordered your YT-1300, you could have it kit out. Yeah.
The solo thing. But the design with the cockpit here, I was like, oh, I actually really dig that.
Yeah.
I didn't care for the one that was hanging out underneath.
It was too satellite-y. Yeah,
but I mean, Jesus Christ, this design. Listen, like, it's not my favorite ship because I like Y-Wings, Blockade Runner, Naboo Starfighters and stuff. But I mean, Jesus Christ, like, the Millennium Falcon, when you go to Star Wars Galaxy's Edge and you see it for the first time, you almost weep.
I can't imagine,
if it was the Blockade Runner, I'm sure, like, and that's the thing too, if it's the Blockade Runner, we wouldn't know any different. If we lived in that universe where it was the Blockade Runner was Han Solo's ship, everyone would love it. It would be on every shirt.
Does it have that same cool factor?
Did it have to be this design for Star Wars to be the phenomenon it was?
Is it like part of the alchemy? Like when Luke walks into, like, we've seen the concept art of the old Falcon in Docking Bay 94. It did look pretty cool, but Luke walking in there, the, what a piece of junk. Like, that whole interaction, if that's not this Millennium Falcon that we all know and love, like, is it the same? Does it hit the same? Like, no one will ever know. That's one of those alternate universe things. I quite like these exposed engine designs that we've got back here on these ones. Like, I think they're kind
that
of
looks
interesting.
It looks like Close Encounters.
Yeah, it does a bit. Yeah.
Like a Close Encounters ship.
It's a fun book. I'm not sure if it's still in print, but yeah, that came out a while ago. I was still working at the comic book shop when that came out.
But that's the kind of stuff that I want to see.
Yeah.
And I want to hear is how it was made, how it was done. And I don't know whose idea this was to put this documentary together. It might have been Kasdan's.
I was gonna say probably Kasdan.
But the thing is, it's like I never thought about wanting it or needing it
because we know so much already.
That panel,
yeah,
right. But the thing is, for me, is I am jealous of John Knoll. Not because he invented Photoshop, not that he did all the digital work for, I don't know, every movie since like True Lies, or I think he did it earlier.
When did he come into the fold? Like, that was mid-90s.
Maybe around the Abyss, maybe.
Okay, late. I have no idea. Okay. Yeah, I'm sure we'll see.
We're going to get there.
Yeah, I can't wait because he's one of those like characters who we all know about. And it's like, yeah, John Knoll's integral.
But the reason I'm jealous of John Knoll is because when he was a kid, his dad took a trip to Anaheim.
Yeah.
I think this is in the Rogue One documentary. And looked up Industrial Light and Magic in the phone book. Asked if he can go there. He was a kid. And they said, yeah, show up. And he got a tour of ILM. And that's why I'm jealous. Because I wish that when I was a kid, when I was a little Star Wars kid and, you know, 5-year-old, Ralph would want to go to ILM.
Yeah.
And this documentary is allowing me to do that.
Yes.
And that's why I'm glad
at the time, not like the full studio that it is now, like, or anything like when it was just a shitty warehouse with a tin roof.
Right. I've seen all the DVD documentaries from all these movies, and watched special effects, know who the guys are, but we've never actually seen what it was like to be in the thick of it in 1976 and beyond. It's going to get to the point where I'm like, oh, it's just, an office building with computers, and that's fine. But at
It's
the
the
same time,
evolution of
just
it.
watching these guys, they're all like mechanics. They're building cameras.
This like the closest thing that I can think of now, seeing this was the appendices on the Lord of the Rings extended editions. And when they're digging into the Weta Workshop side of things, because Weta very much came from that same school of ILM, but they were just down in New Zealand. And it's that same thing that it takes a George, it takes a Peter Jackson to just go, I'll do it myself. I'll set up my own company because these guys aren't doing what I want and need for this project. So let's
James
just do it.
Cameron
I'll
has
put the
one
team
too, right?
together. Who's that, sir?
James Cameron has one, has his own effects.
I think he does now, but he still uses
Digital
ILM
domain?
for. Is digital domain his?
I could be wrong. I don't know. I don't
Maybe.
even know why I brought it up,
But it
but.
also like it feels like he still relies on ILM for a lot of
Right.
things. Like they're still doing things like Avatar and stuff. Like that's all still ILM, I believe. So it is really fascinating. But yeah, seeing that just the in-depthness of it, it's like the last time that we got a documentary that I can remember this focused was those appendices. But of course they were just talking about those movies.
And to see the background of these guys is more than just lumping them all into Pillsbury Doughboy. Like seeing a
Oh.
lot of their kids' films and stuff.
It makes you go, okay, cool, right, you're the right people. The sort of thing that we grow up, we watch, and it's like, oh, I wish I could do that. I'd love to do that. They didn't wish that they could do that. They just did it. They were just picking this up, and they were all doing it on their own. They were getting this super low tech, like equipment, really, and doing stuff that I couldn't even think to do now without the help of some assistance.
Their kids, their films, what they did when they're kids, the optical compositing was astounding. I'm like, holy shit, this looks better than movies at that time. It's insane.
And they were doing it all manually. It's all them, like there isn't an app that is just putting in these effects for them. They're like, this is all them going in and essentially creating. I mean, we saw them creating the motion control camera rigs later on, but they're doing a rudimentary version of that at home when they're like 12 years old.
And the fact that they're all like a big chunk of them, a lot of the stop motion guys all just met each other at a dude's house who ran the
Famous
Monsters
movies
of
of
Filmland.
Monfalant. Yeah, Filmland. Ken Russell's films here.
There's a film that Criterion released called Equinox, and it's a giant monster movie. I believe I haven't seen it in forever. I don't even think I've seen it all the way through, but Dennis Muren did that. I think it's from 1970. And just watching the films as them as a kid and seeing it, his progression towards Equinox, and then going into like Star Wars and stuff. Like, it's crazy. Like, it seems like they all, it's like they were already part of sort of an inner circle, and John Dykstra was like getting people from his school. And once he got like Dennis Muren or Ken Ralston or something, like he brought in a bunch of people with
But
him.
it's even if he didn't know him directly, that guy would know that guy, and that guy would know that guy. And they've all got, because they all either went to the same schools or were in the same circles, they've all got slightly different specialities.
It's funny because they knew each other through hanging out together through a magazine. Like, there's no message boards. How
They
do you
didn't meet. They
find
were,
these people?
I mean, writing in letters, I guess, every month to the magazine.
Conventions?
Conventions, possibly, yeah. But it's wild. Or, contacting the editor and saying, hey, I really like that guy's letter. Can you give me his phone number? Or something, it's gonna be something like that. It's weird. It's a weird wild time. Like I look back on the early 2000s fondly, and like the message boards and being on, like, I mean, staying in with Star Wars, being on like the force.net's literacy message boards and talking about books with those people. Like I remember that sort of time of the internet fondly, and for these guys, it was the letters pages of famous movies of Filmland. It's it's cool.
And then Joe Johnston coming in and redesigning the X-Wings and TIE Fighters, like, it sucks for the other dude,
but I much prefer the new designs.
Yeah,
he's right. Like, massively undercredited amount of work that Joe Johnston did on Star Wars. Like, I've always more thought of Joe Johnston because his name sort of appears higher in the credits for Return of the Jedi. I always sort of just, I knew he'd worked on the other two, but I always assumed that that was where he sort of put in most of his work.
Spoiler alert, but he designs the Star Wars font that we talked about.
That one. Yeah.
And it was another last minute thing.
Yeah.
He had to get it done overnight because George was like, oh shit, we need a logo.
Was it Joe Johnston who also did the Star Trek font? Or was that someone else of the ILM team?
Was that Richard Edlund?
It might have been. But one of them, like, again, the Star Trek font that's still used to this day was just one of these guys was like, I'm just doing a quick redesign and, you know, but no credit. Never made any money off of it or anything. But he's like, whatever.
He's like, I never saw a dime. It's still being used today, but hey, it's cool. It's out there.
That
to me was amazing. Like, of all the things you do, you probably design the second most famous font in all of film. Sort of sci-fi.
Yeah.
And you're just like, that's okay. I didn't make any money from it. But
that's the thing. Like, so many of these guys were moonlighting. Like, this wasn't their day job.
Who created the pig nose amp? Someone did.
It was someone else. And like, and even like the matte painting, the matte painter was they. That was all. He was just moonlighting. He was going to his day job at Disney, working on like, or his dad had worked on Mary Poppins or whatever. And it's like they were all. It was such a stuffy sort of like suit and tie, like jobs for the boys kind of like Disney atmosphere. And then he'd be like, I'll come down here. I miss all the fun of like the lunch parties where they're in the car park playing on slip and slides. But
yeah, he was great because he could tell he really didn't want to do matte painting. And you could tell that he probably felt like, I cannot be as good as my dad.
Yeah.
But his dad was doing like London skylines and trees and stuff. And this dude was like, oh man, well, I mean, I'm not as good as my dad, but I can do straight lines for the Death Star.
Yeah, I can do some spaceship, like generic spaceship sort of designs.
Yeah.
And even like not as good as his dad, but still better than 90% of other matte painters out there, sort of thing. It's like, yeah, it's your basis of comparison.
Also, Star Wars wasn't Star Wars yet. So as far as he knows, like, I'll just make sure it looks as good as it can for this stupid old man walking across this ledge that makes no sense.
Yeah.
If you want me to do that, I'll do it. And he did it. And I think that's one of my things I like is that Star Wars wasn't precious then.
No.
It wasn't.
And none of
precious.
Them were precious about it.
No. And they just did what they had to do because they're like, it's.
They were getting paid to job, all hang out. They were getting paid to all hang out together. And it's a lot of them were people that had known each other for years. And they were like, oh, cool. We can do a job together and we can innovate. And so that's what they were doing. They were like, all of these ideas that they might have had individually, they're coming together and they're throwing them around in a group and you're creating, and they've got a budget. And when you hear about them saying, oh yeah, but this machine is going to cost $1,300, and they're like, yeah, why don't we already have it? Like, go and get it right now. Go take the car.
Yeah.
We've got millions of dollars budget from a studio. Like, they don't care that you're spending $1,300 on a bit of equipment that we can use again and again.
Yeah. Yeah. The watching this versus watching the episode one documentary with George Lucas with his stamp and his highlighters and stuff. It's so different because Lucas has no involvement with this as far as episode one goes.
Not yet, anyway, of this show
has no involvement with the exception of, I don't like the ships, make them different. And then they made them different, but it seems like it's mostly all the effects and stuff are up to the artists. And I like that. There is still a little bit of a George filter, but when it came to like episode one, when it came to like episode one, George Lucas was there over the shoulders, looking at like tons of maquettes and storyboards and just with this three highlighters going through and then stamping good and stuff. And so I feel like George probably handpicked the people for episode one, mm-hmm. and he probably, and he just definitely was funding himself, and he was there from beginning to end.
It's where he comes in the process. Whereas like, yeah, from that, he was there during like concept. Whereas this, he might've seen some of those concepts, but then when it actually comes to the practicality of making them and making them usable or like visually interesting on screen, these guys had free reign to tweak and change stuff.
Also,
and then it was a case of, by the time he got back, they were like, well, this is how it is because we've got 6 months. You're getting on our backs now to get it finished. We're just going to go with this one because it's ready.
And then cut to episode one where he has John Knoll on set overlooking every single shot.
Yeah.
So there's more. I mean, I guess that's good as far as George being able to have his vision completely done at all times. But at the same time, I kind of like the sort of, we're doing our own thing over here. We're going to make it look good, but just give us some time. And I mean, look at the effects in Star Wars are great.
It's amazing. Like, again, it's 1977 that it comes out and it still holds up. Even when you take away the specializations from, you know, nearly 30 years ago now, like it still looks great.
And I'm not saying like one's better than the other, but
no,
it is fun. Like in the last, I don't know, 20 years, how many DVD documentaries have we seen where they show people on computers with wireframes and explain to us how they animate it and stuff? I just don't care. I want to know who this guy is. Like, I want to know this guy who built a Star Destroyer.
I really hope that as we go through the rest of the series and as the team expands, we still get like basically a profile of each of these guys. Cause I feel like everyone we got to know them before we were shown what they were doing.
Right. I'm sure by episode, when they do cover Empire, we'll get more into Phil Tippett.
Yeah.
Cause he did primarily stop motion.
Mm-hmm.
And so he came in with, I know he'll discuss Tauntauns cause I saw the footage
of him discussing Tauntauns. The Tauntauns are the Wampa and how, you know, things that work and things that don't work. Like, I'm looking forward to seeing the failures.
Yeah. So much more stop motion in Empire.
It really is.
And then Jedi. But then like after that, like who are some of the well known effects guys after this group of people?
But
John Knoll,
like, but I mean I'm sure that there's guys that have worked on everything, but because we haven't been following them and there hasn't been this sort of documentary yet, we just don't know their names as well. Like, it might be a sort of name that you see it, and then next time you watch a movie, you're like, oh, there's his name. Of course, he's one of the high ups in ILM now. Hopefully, I hope that is the case.
Yeah, I'm sure. I don't know. So far, so good. And then everybody's been binging. I have a friend who's made it through 5. I have another friend who's made it through 3. And it just sounds like it's like smooth sailing.
I mean, if you wanted to talk about 2 episodes a week and then do a couple of data links before Andor, I'm down because I could easily do a couple.
I can get through this real quick.
Yeah, I think we could. We'll talk about it off air. But like, yeah, like I'm cool with that. Like, it would be good.
Yeah, I think I have a possible schedule that I can figure out real easy. Mm-hmm. Cool. I think we can do, there's this one. We could do 2-3 as an episode in 2 weeks, 3-4 as an episode in 2 weeks. No, then it'll hit Andor. We'll figure it out. Yeah. We'll figure it out. Yeah, it'll be fine. But the sooner the better.
Yeah.
In fact, definitely. I don't know. I think we can probably get these knocked out in a couple weeks,
and also,
I think we've got
at least one or two people that want to guest on, and I've got a couple of Wednesdays that I'm, or at least one of these Wednesdays that I'm available, like without any time frame, so we can get some guests on hopefully.
I don't have much more to say about this. We've only been going 40 minutes, which is fine.
I think that's the thing when we're talking about behind the scenes documentaries of things from so long ago that we talk about some of this stuff whenever we're talking about any of the narrative. So it makes sense that, you know, when it comes to talking about the documentary side of it, we're not going to have as much to say, which is another reason why I think doing a couple of episodes at a time would work quite nicely. Mm-hmm. So yeah, we'll see.
But we get him out of the way.
Yeah. gives us a little bit of a breather as well in between this and Andor.
Right. Right.
Because we're not getting any time off between then and
that's the fucked up one. That's the one where I'm gonna be up at 5:30 for 13 weeks.
I think I worked it out and I think half of not in concession, but like about half of them I'm off on the Wednesday. So we can
but I mean I don't mind.
Get them out early.
I like the 7:30 start times.
Cool.
We'll see. It depends on guests and if we can do it a little bit later. But I like doing the 7:30s. I like having the shows out there.
It's cool. And as we've said many a time, we like with those shows, we like being able to get it out before anything, before there's much discourse online, before like anything that we think or
Twitter
see.
Opinions.
Yeah, basically before they start infecting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll figure it all out. Is there anything else we need to talk about? Like we normally run about an hour and it's been 41 minutes.
No, I mean, I might know about your
episode that you did on Monday with.
Yeah. On Monday, me and Adam jumped on and we talked about Shadows of the Sith, which is just there. You can see it. Great book. We talked about it. It wasn't like a strict review or anything, but we just had a chat about everything. Yeah. A chat and a discussion about everything that we enjoyed and what we'd like to see. So yeah, check it out. If it's piqued any interest, hopefully we didn't spoil too much, but please do check that book out. It's well worth watching, reading, listening to, however you consume it.
And then I don't really mention this a lot on here, but I have another show called Cue the Music, looking for subscribers. So if you guys want to go check that out, I will be doing, it's a film score / mostly vinyl. I do. Like essentially those are the two main topics, and coming up I will have opening unboxing, I guess, of the Rogue One Deluxe Edition.
Ooh, awesome.
That is currently in the mail.
I can't wait for that one.
So
a little crossover with Star Wars. Whenever there's a new release, I'm sure there's some level of crossover.
And I'll post that episode on the live action Star Wars Twitter and stuff. But
I kind of
been thinking about asking the composer to join me on that episode.
That'd be cool.
I don't know. I don't know.
He's kind of busy.
He's a little bit busy, but not necessarily right now. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. We'll see. We'll see.
Yeah.
I'm debating on whether to do it with him or not, but we'll see.
I think it'd be very cool. Just
with Andor out. Coming up, I don't think he has anything to do with Andor. He's definitely not scoring it, but
no.
Yeah.
Do we know who is scoring Andor?
We do know. I don't remember.
Yeah, that sounds right.
But let me just talk real quick. My second favorite composer of all time is the composer of Light and Magic, James Newton Howard.
Oh, awesome. I didn't realize. That's amazing.
James Newton Howard. It was funny that he announced it a couple weeks ago. And I'm like, of course, like Lawrence Kasdan did that movie Dreamcatcher and James Newton Howard did music. But for some reason, I'm like, man, what if James Newton Howard did that? And he's doing it.
That's great.
The music, it's they didn't get an orchestra. It's all done through
digital
orchestra, which doesn't bother me at all during the documentary, but it sticks out like a sore thumb during the skip intro, the opening titles.
Oh, okay.
And the end titles. The end titles of this one was a little strange because it had like theremin sci-fi sounds in it. I'm like, okay, I get it because it came from old sci-fi. I'm like, that makes sense. But
now that you said it, I'm not going to be able to miss it, am I?
Go back and watch the end credits of this. Listen to the music.
I'm gonna watch episode two later, so
Well, I don't know if it's the same. If it's we'll same end credits music, then I'm like, oh, that's weird. For this one, my justification for it being okay was this is came from like guys who are into monsters and sci-fi and UFOs, so it worked for this episode. But the fact that they didn't use an orchestra, I wish they would have used an orchestra for the opening credits, because it sounded a little bit cheaper.
Mm.
And it does, it's not noticeable throughout the show at all because you're in the story and the
yeah,
music.
You're not paying perfectly. Exactly.
But when you're sitting there watching an image and just listening to music, it sticks out a little bit more. So
yeah.
I wish there was an orchestra for that, but that's fine. I'm hoping it gets released digitally. I don't see why they wouldn't.
Maybe. Yeah. They've done everything else that they've put out. So
it's just content. It's content that they have. They could just toss up.
They can get the streams. They can get the revenue off that. So yeah.
But yeah, I love James Newton Howard and I'm so happy.
Yeah.
I'm so happy he did the music for this. But yeah, that's all I have for this. And, look for that Rogue One unboxing. We'll see how that goes. I
might. And when's that coming? Do you know? Sometime soon.
As far as I know, it's in the mail.
Okay. So potentially.
She sent it to me.
Cool.
Cause there's not a, it's yeah. It got sent to me.
That's cool. Look forward to it. So that'll be coming soon. But before that, next week, we're going to have at least episode two of Light and Magic, potentially episodes 2 and 3.
We're going to hash this out. We're going to hash this out after we go off the air.
Yeah.
And then go to liveactionstarwars.com, which is our YouTube channel. And you'll see when our next episode is happening and what it's going to be titled. Yes. So you'll see if it's one.
You'll know what homework you got to do by next week.
Yeah.
And that'll be back on Wednesday. Wednesday, our regular time, 7:30 in the morning, West Coast, 3:30 afternoon, UK. You can figure out the rest. Cool. Until then, there you go. So, yeah, we got youtube.com/liveactionstarwars, twitter.com, live action SW
everywhere. You got it. Leave reviews. If you're not subscribed for some reason to our channel, like, guys, we want the subscriptions. We're trying to hit that 1,000 mark, and we got a ways to go. So share this with your friends. I try to share this on Facebook. Facebook algorithm doesn't like it. So
probably because neither of us actually use Facebook enough to sort of push it, but it goes there.
It's up to you guys to help us out with that. So please help us.
Yes.
And
that's cool. That's gonna wrap us up. I'm gonna be able to get to work without having to run so much. But until next week, when I probably will have to run a little bit quicker, don't give in to hate.
Celebrate the love.
Punch it.